Let's talk about family. Hey everyone, welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. As you guys know, I announced last week that I'd be doing this subject matter. It's about LGBT people making good with their conservative family. So if you're at a stage in your gayness, your LGBTness, where you're kind of like on a hate train about your family, I feel you. I've been there. I'm a little past that point. I'm actually in the recovery stage where I'm okay with my queerness. It is not a matter of my family not being okay with it. That's the issue completely, because I've radically accepted them for who they are, religious people. But instead, it's about what do we do now? After we've accepted our family for who they are and ourselves for who we are, how do we create a healthy relationship between our gayness and who we are and our family's religious or conservative background? So if this sounds like it's for you, please stay tuned. Before we jump in, today I'm not drinking a tea. I'm drinking an apple cider vinegar water honey mix. You guys have seen me do this in the past. I've noticed that I'm just experiencing a lot of allergy-related things, and I also feel a little, when I'm clogged, I don't know what word to use, but when I feel like I'm just, you know, suffocating, I like to drink the apple cider vinegar mixes. I just feel like it cleanses me in so many good ways. So that's what I'll be having today. So the first thing I need to say is this. My family is so important to me. They are my inner circle. I love them. I am not here to make a bashing video about them. In no way, shape, or form am I sharing the details of my personal life as a way for people to, you know, feel vindicated in being mean towards each other. The idea of this is to be able to observe where I've been and where I've come and where I'm going in relation to my relationship with my parents. So as an example, okay, a couple weeks ago, I went to my mom's house for her birthday. It was really fun. It was a really good week. I did plan to stay a pretty long time. I think it was about 7 or 8 days. And so far, it was really great. Like the first 3-4 days was really awesome, totally good, a little bit of tension, but not too much, which is per the course. For details, in case you guys are new to my channel, my parents are immigrants. They're from Iraq. They're Catholic. They're super conservative. But over time, over the last like decade or so, all their children have challenged a lot of their beliefs. And though they've remained steadfast to their beliefs, they've also been able to welcome their children in their homes, regardless if their children have lived with partners. I mean, hell, I've even brought boyfriends to my parents' house that I was living with at the time, and I never thought as a teenager I'd be able to do that. My parents know that I smoke pot. So they, over time, have become a lot more lax on a lot of the things that, as a child, I thought they would never be chill with. And again, it's not that they're chill with it so much as they're not going to ban us from the house for it. Okay. Interestingly enough, though, the last thing that they're still trying to get over is the gay thing. Now, whether or not they will ever, I'm not sure. Because remember, for me, homosexuality, especially coming from Iraq, like, there wasn't a lot of exposure of good representation of homosexuality. The only people that Iraqis really, at least in my family, that they ever recognized as gay people were the men who were cheating on their wives and hiding at parks and being promiscuous, or grown men who were child predators going after children. So again, it wasn't a good representation. I think that's a lot of the issue that a lot of humans have when experiencing something new or other. They just hold steadfast to the association they have with it and forget to change and update their information, which is where bias comes in, right? So we're dealing with trauma and bias, and parents who are old school, don't believe in therapy, and therefore really cling to the tenets of their religion to help guide them when they're in turbulence. So here I am at my mom's house. It's going really good. And I specify my mom's house, not because it's not my dad's house, but because my dad and I have a very clear friendship relationship. We have a very understood boundary of I'm open, but I have boundaries. My dad also is very much a man in the regard of, like, his rule is don't ask questions you don't want answers to. Well, my mother is the kind of human that asks the question hoping for the answer she wants to hear over and over and over again until it literally hurts her. So we're hanging out with my parents. We've run out of things to talk about that are safe. And now that means we're getting into the next territory of questioning, which is about homosexuality. So my mother brings up the gay thing. Specifically, I think we were talking about that. You know, she was saying something to the effect of, Brittany, I can't wait, you know, till you meet your Catholic husband. And I was like, Mom, please, like, why would you want a Catholic husband to marry me? This is a conversation I have with my mom almost every time we talk about relationships. I know I repeat it a lot on this channel, but I'm not exaggerating. These are just conversations that I have to prepare to always have with my family. So I go over, my mom asks this question. I say, you know, Mom, I really just need a guy who can see me for who I am. And she goes, what does that mean? I was like, well, he's just got to see me for who I am. You know, all the parts of me. And she goes, well, what do you mean? Are you talking about gay stuff? You know, something to that effect. Somehow we always talk about gay stuff. And I was like, well, you know, if I'm bisexual, I want him to see that part of me. And my mom is quite old school, so she doesn't quite understand the concept of bisexuality. Like, I'm not exaggerating. When I was younger, there really was no option for it. Like, many of you were here 12 years ago during my YouTube journey, and you guys saw, right, me coming out as a lesbian. And that was because I was told, hey, you have to choose one, men or women. And I was like, well, I guess I'll choose women, right? So I came out as a lesbian. But the truth is that I'm bisexual. I like men and I like women. And I told my mom, look, it's really simple. I love you. I love my family. I want to marry a man. It's more efficient. I'd like to be able to bring him home. I'd like him to be here for when we aren't getting along and when I need the comfort of a partner. I'd like him to benefit from knowing you all because you're all so wonderful, even with all of our differences. And she was frustrated by this because she's like, don't date a man just for this family. And I was like, no, it's for me because I'm going to need the care of a partner when these kinds of conversations happen because they impact me. So I'm a very big believer in being reasonable with your expression of emotion, but being honest as well. So I'm a crier. And so I actively cry in front of my parents when they're upsetting me when it comes to gay stuff. And I let them know, this hurts me as your child. I'm not judging your beliefs. I'm allowing you to know your actions are frustrating. So if you don't want to have gay conversations, just don't ask. And I'm happy to pretend it's 1993 and Bill Clinton just signed Don't Ask, Don't Tell. I have no interest in explaining my homosexual parts to my parents if it makes them upset, right? I'm not here to come to, I don't want to go to my mom's house and make her upset. That's not my goal. But the problem is my mother, being the secretly intellectual masochist she might be, you know, has to ask the question, what are you going to do when you have kids? Are you going to tell them you're bisexual? Yes, mom, of course I'm going to tell them I'm bisexual. Betsy, why would you do this? Why would you put into the heads of your children that gayness is real? And I'm like, oh, really? You don't think Mark is really gay? No. You guys were all corrupted by the liberal media. This is stuff she says that I know she doesn't believe. This is when I know she's upset. And when I hear her say these things, I have to take a moment and use my understanding of psychology to step back and say, okay, I know my mother. I know psychology 101 a little bit, right? I'm well read. What I know about these things is that this isn't my mom talking because my mom knows we're gay. Because my mom is sus anytime I'm around a girl. My mom knows Mark's gay because she brought it up when he was like 3-4 years old. She came to me because I was newly out at the time. And or maybe it was just before because I was really into gay people since I was a kid and my mom knew. So she came to me and said, if Mark is ever gay, I'm going to blame you. Well, congratulations. My brother is a homosexual, right? So we understand that our parents, even when they say things in moments of being in heat, like they're heated up or whatever, they're in conflict, they're angry, they're going to say things they don't really mean. My allergies. Okay, so we know our parents, right? We know when they're being themselves and when they're saying things because they're in pain and so they're lashing out. So again, because my parents have gotten so much better over time, that is why I'm open but have boundaries with them. If my parents were still the parents they were in like 2006, you know what I mean? I would not engage with them. But because my parents have gotten better and they've welcomed their kids and learned to calm down about the things they thought they could never accept. My mom, when she found out I had a tattoo on my back, literally thought my dad was going to kick me out of the house. And my dad looked at me playing clarinet and he went, well, it's already on your back, so there's not much I can do about it now. And that's my dad, right? My dad's just very much like, what are you going to do, right? I've made my peace. My kids are adults. They're going to make decisions. My mother is a woman. And so in a large way, she's very like, please, please. Like, she suffocates you in order for you to make the right decision, which of course, because her children are all rebellious, pushed us a lot away. So even myself, even my brothers, like my mom said to me while I was visiting, Betsy, go date a woman, go date her, go. And I was like, oh, don't you tempt me, mom, I'm gonna get on all the apps right now. And the thing is like, I don't wanna do that to a woman. I would never think to ask a queer person who went on a journey like mine, hi, I know you spent all this time trying to come out and be yourself and be accepted. Would you like to marry into a family where you will have no in-laws? Our children will have no grandparents on my side. Oh, and the time I do visit my parents, if I ever do, you can't come with me. Why would I ever do that to a woman? Why would I ever do that to a woman? Why would I ever do that to her? Right? So again, we can call this what it is. You guys can see me and think I'm crazy for indulging my parents, but it's not about indulging my parents. It's about playing the long game because I'm trying to get them ready to have queer grandkids. I'm trying to get them ready to have trans grandkids just in case. I don't know that my kids will be these things. That's not guaranteed, of course. Maybe they won't be, you know, but they could be. And so I need them to learn how to chill before that happens. So yeah, I take the hit this generation, but the next generation is going to benefit. I am planning to stop the cycle in my bloodline of this anti-gay, anti-LGBT rhetoric that I grew up with. I'm not interested in carrying it on to my future kids or grandkids. So in order to do that, I have to take the hit now, according to my understanding of what's happening, to make this happen. So this is just a decision I'm making. This is not a decision you have to make. So I did get some questions. I asked you guys to submit them on the last podcast. So I'm going to go ahead and try to answer them right now. It says, I can't wait for next week's podcast. You've talked about choosing to date men as a bi woman because you are close to your family. But that if you fall in love with a woman, then you fall in love with a woman. If that happens, how would you navigate it? Would you try to warm this person up to your family? Would you put your lover in your life you want to build with her above the want to be close to your family? Would you just break up with her? Maybe you wouldn't allow yourself to fall in love in the first place. These are all really good questions. And as bisexuals, I think that want to have relations with their conservative family, we have to think about our options. Like Mark is gay. So like he, like homosexual, like gay. So he doesn't have like an option like I do of at least having a partner that could get along with the family. So here in this question, I want to just focus on a few things. One, the fact that you noticed that I did say that. You're the second person to bring it up to me. I did specify in my last podcast about bisexuality and dating men that if a woman were to, for some reason, come into my life and we were to fall in love, like, that's it, boo. I'm loyal, right? And so for me, I thought it was interesting that only two people brought that up to me. The rest seem to either ignore it, or some people in particular seem to not hear it at all, meaning they thought, oh, here you are denying your gayness, that's so interesting, like blah blah blah. No, I'm not denying my gayness. I'm trying to be efficient with my gayness. Like I said just seconds ago, why would I ask a queer person, a queer woman who's gone through so much struggle, hi, marry into this family that will not accept you? Now, you know, how would I navigate this? Like, would I just break up with her? Or would I even fall in love with her in the first place? My goal is not to fall in love with a woman in the first place. But you know how love happens, girls. It just comes out of nowhere sometimes. And that's just how it goes. So if this happened, what would I do? I would explain what they're marrying into and what they're, you know, involving themselves with. If they consent and we decide to take this battle on together, then I'm going to have to rush the process of my parents coming around to gayness in a very, you know, contextual manner. All I want from my parents is either to be radically themselves and to be calm when I visit and not to bring up issues that will cause controversy, or they can get past this issue and really process that within Catholicism and that bubble, yes, gayness is not okay. I'm not asking for that to change. But since I'm not Catholic, I don't believe in a God, I'm asking them to meet me where I am. I'm open to all the options. Or they can make a decision in which they feel they need to remove themselves from my life, but my family, we all love each other way too much, and we're way too needy, and we spend way too much good time together. 99% of the time we spend together is amazing. Amazing. So in our heads, you know, we're all just waiting to see what happens with that 1%. So yes, if I marry a woman for whatever reason and that happens, then obviously my partner comes first. My family would respect that. My parents would not respect me if I chose them over my partner. My parents do heavily believe that once you are married, that is your relationship and you owe your partner priority over everybody, even your own kids. So for my culture, like yes, absolutely, I would be 100% focused on my partner. So this next question I got says, how do you radically accept your family without re-traumatizing yourself? I've moved away to get away from certain toxic people in my life, but because I love my family, I've always dreamed of moving back. Now that I'm working on my trauma and therapy with the idea that maybe moving back isn't the best idea for me, the toxic people in my family are still affecting my loved ones back home, and the healed version of me will fit back into that family system. All right, I love this question. Okay, let's just have this conversation, right? We love our family, and our family is at conflict with our beliefs. And then we have to make a decision, right? Part of being a responsible adult, and how to move forward with our lives. I think the motivator for a lot of myself in my 20s, well, okay, let me say it this way. I have borderline personality disorder. It means it's rooted in like a fear of abandonment. My therapist thinks it comes from the gay thing, knowing as a child, very young, prepubescently, that I was worthless and that I would die and that I should commit suicide, or maybe if I did, you know, either way, it wouldn't matter if I died and killed myself or if I stayed alive, I was going to hell because I was gay. And I had a lot of trauma around that abandonment. My parents they played a really big game when we were young of saying like, my way, the highway, out of the house at 18, you know, follow the rules or you're out. Or they would say things like gay people are disgusting or we don't like gay people. They were very sus anytime any of us were on the computer or had access to the internet because they knew we had a a habit, because we're children, of Googling things we don't know about. So like porn and therefore gay things and, you know. Anyways, and it was also the time when Ellen was coming out and John was confirming his homosexuality and all these like big celebrities were finally coming out. So my parents doubled down. They went hard on the gay thing and it became a very toxic environment, a very confusing one. My parents felt like they were losing control of their children and their children were going down a path of hell and it started to scare them. And so and as a way to protect us, they tried to like save us and it didn't work. It suffocated us, which made us more rebellious, which didn't work out in their favor. Now, I'm not saying my parents are evil for doing this. I'm saying they made a decision at the time they thought was best and it didn't actually work out the greatest. Now, in hindsight, as they got older, as we got older, by the time I was 15, my parents had another shift. It was one where they doubled down into themselves, experienced depression and confusion about their religion in conjunction with their children. But then they stopped doing certain things that they had done when we were younger kids. We grew up in a corporal punishment household, like we're Middle Eastern. If your dad did not hit you with a slipper, like I don't even know, like on the Elta, like I don't even know how to have a conversation with you growing up. So it was like pretty normal. And I know some Americans think it's like really outlandish, but I'm going to be real, like Chaldean, Middle Eastern, Asian, like we all got stories about our parents beating us. I think you guys need to let us work through that on our own. I just don't like kids who didn't grow up with it having a large opinion about it, because for some of us, we knew that it worked. And for some of us, it didn't always work. Like I remember distinctly when it stopped working. I remember my siblings and I made it like a competition, like who could get a whooping the hardest and handle it, right? Like that was the psychology of the children. But again, we want to be very careful that we are not talking about parents who deserve jail time. We're not talking about parents who beat their kids black and blue in a significant way that you would imagine maybe happened with like the child called it. Like if you read that book, right? That's like child abuse. Some people could argue I grew up in a very toxic home. But again, I hate to tell you this. There's a fine line between cultural tradition and abuse. And sometimes the line was toted, but it never really went to that evil side. So we were really lucky. You know what I mean? Okay, so here we are. We have this family. We have this moment. I'm seeing my family grow. I'm seeing my parents grow, my siblings grow. I remember when I came out, it was so hard and devastating. I moved out. I wrote my parents a letter. I handed it to my brother to hand to my parents. I said, give this to dad. I said, don't give it to mom. Give it to dad. Because if you give it to mom, she will hide it from dad. And what did my brother do? Give it to my mom. And what did my mom do? Hide it from my dad. So how did my dad hear me coming out when I posted a YouTube video thinking he had already read the letter so he knew? It was months later and here I am posting this video. My dad hears, relatives are calling from Iraq, the whole family's getting involved. And here I am like, oh my God, it's happening again. When I was a teenager, because this is when I was 21. I came out at 21 officially, but when I was a teenager, I messed with the homosexual thing a lot, asking kids in my homeschool group, in my public high school group, you know, are you gay? Do you know what being gay is? Do you know what that's like? I was really afraid. My first cousin tried to out me when I was 17, and out of protection for myself, I doubled down and said I don't like girls as much as I like boys. And that is sort of not, I mean, I'm bisexual, so like that was very confusing, but that's the way I justified it. I lied. I said, no, she's lying. I'm not gay. And I knew if I told her, she would use this against me, but I thought we're best friends. We've known each other our whole life. You're my first cousin. Why would you do this to me? And then she did it to me. And then years later, when we all went to go confront her again, she denied it. I never said that. That's not what I said. Anyways, overall, it ended up being this whole story where she didn't want to continue friendship with me just because we were cousins. Which is why I think consent is like the root of all of these controversies that we're having for the most part. If my cousin had just felt safe coming to me and ending our friendship, maybe she wouldn't felt a need to out me to my family to end it. And the irony is that I would have understood if she didn't want to be friends with me anymore, if she had just explained it to me. Because I grew up with a mother who made it very clear I didn't and was not obligated to be best friends with my cousins unless I wanted to be, which meant for me that our friendships were really genuine and organic. But for my cousin, who was apparently only friends with me because we were cousins, this was not the case. And we were children trying to navigate this very serious thing. And then what did it do overall? It did the worst thing. It tore our families apart. Now, some of the families made amends. Some of them didn't. We've kind of all had ups and downs in the last 15 years. But regardless, all of this is surrounded and tainted by the gayness. Because I grew up in a family where, like, if you were gay, it meant you were basically a predator. And so my parents were so afraid of me coming out. When I came out and my Middle Eastern relatives, like, embraced me, I was so relieved because I was like, you're gonna, you know, let me be with your kids and you're not gonna treat me like a predator. And they were like, no, we don't believe that. But that was so cultural. That was so assumed of gay people in the Middle Eastern, like, you know, realm of the world, that like this was perversion and this was evil. And so it felt like really amazing, you know, and it still does. I know for a fact my parents do not see me as evil. I know for a fact they do not hate me. They are so afraid for my soul, though. They really believe with all their heart that God exists. And again, modern religious people will justify their homosexuality within their religions as if to say they know the heart of God. But I would argue with you, you're all playing with a belief that I'm not involved in, because I don't, my life isn't predicated on a belief system of a supernatural being. So when Christians come to me and they're like, Brittany, you can still be religious and believe in Jesus and be gay and all these. No, I don't want to be gay and Christian. I'm just gay. I'm just gay. I don't need to be at church. I don't believe in the supernatural, okay? So how do you make amends with your family when how do you know when it's time to break off? I think it's a matter of them getting better. So I'm open, but I have boundaries policy with everybody, including you guys. So I have people in my inner circle that I see very, very few times I probably see them once every few years. And because of this, our relationship has gotten better. I know some people would say, oh, if you really love this person and they were really in your inner circle, you'd see them all the time. But boo, distance makes the heart grow fonder. Even with my mother, we have like a 3-4 day good time. Great time. Gardening, books, theology, religion, politics, philosophy, great conversations about everything. But after that time, when all those subjects are talked about, then we get into the gay stuff and it gets crazy again, right? Because again, because my family doesn't believe in therapy, even though some of their kids have gone therapy, my parents are against it. They will never heal from their traumas. They will never get better from their childhood and what they went through being immigrants and everything. And so I just have to accept that. I have to meet them where they are. But even without therapy, they have gotten so much better. Calmer, more interested in listening, still doubling down, but you know whose parents don't. But they don't have the same, there's not the same walking on eggshells that there used to be when we were children. Like, I'm not exaggerating with you. I mean, walking on eggshells because you were just like, you did not want to get in trouble, right? And now it doesn't feel that way. Sure, we still have an edge about us. Sure, after being there for like an hour, I'm like, someone hand me a joint. I get it. But I still love being with my family. Now, I'm an adapter. I'm a person who adapts into my environment really well. And then when I come home, I gay it up and I feel better about myself. So when I'm at my family's home, I can conservative it up, which creates a false narrative in their minds. They'll say something like, oh, I'm so glad you're coming back to our side. And I'm like, ooh, about that. Because here's the thing. When my parents say that, when they go, oh, Brittany, it sounds like you're becoming more conservative because you found parts of Jordan Peterson's work that you really liked. And I was like, yes, I did. That is a fact that there are parts of Jordan Peterson's work that I very much enjoy. You know, and so to them, they're like, oh, this is such good news because he's on our side. And then my feminist friends hear that and they go, oh, you're going over to that side. And I'm like, everyone, calm down. I'm not part of any of your sides. I live literally in the void of my own ideas. I do not want to be a part of your little collectives. And the reason I say that is because I don't fit into the cookie cutterness of these worlds, right? At the end of the day, like, I'm still an OnlyFans. I'm still naked. I'm still queer. I'm still going to Pride. I'm still enjoying my life in a very non-conservative way. I don't believe polyamory is wrong or open relationships is unethical. I think it's fine to be pro-choice. Like, obviously, I'm not a conservative. And so it's very hard when we're hanging out with our loved ones, whether they're friends or family, not to always feel like we're being pulled in a specific direction because they need us to fit a narrative that fits their bubble. Again, the world of the twos means you live in existence in which you were born into a concept or you live in a specific bubble, and this bubble is the radical correct bubble. And what I'm saying is that there are a lot of bubbles that fit a lot of people, and I live in a reality where, like, girls, I'm sorry, I just don't value the same things you value. And I do not think where, you know, the conversation of whether or not homosexuality is ethical is one that can happen if we all go in wanting a specific answer. When I'm around my queer friends, my LGBT friends, my trans, you know, gay friends, when we're having conversations about this and we ask ourselves, hey, do you think our transness is weird or our gayness is weird? We're not asking because we need a particular answer to happen, because we've accepted that we are humans who are attracted or humans who experience gender in a particular way. So once you've accepted yourself, now the mystery question of what am I becomes a lot less scary, except when you're dealing with the world of the twos that are coming at you and telling you, now that you've admitted this thing is this way or this way, we can treat you this way. And I'm saying, no, You cannot decide to treat people off a very specific thing. Like, you cannot say, oh, as a gay person, I'm only going to treat you as a human if you were born that way. Because that makes no sense, right? Realistically, it's not a matter of born this way or not. I think that's so not important. What's important is, do the actions welcome this amount of harassment or lack of job stability or lack of ability to adopt or start a family? Is this an appropriate reaction from culture and society, you know, against the gay and, you know, the LGBT, you know, community? I think that's really the question we're asking. So how do we make amends with our family and how do we find balance? By recognizing our limitations. I cannot handle my mother for longer. Like, once she's in the mode of asking about gay things, I will start becoming unhinged. And so the moment I notice myself saying things I don't mean, like petty mean things I don't mean, I'll recognize it and say, you know what, Mom, I think we're going down a path of just non-communication and I'd rather walk away. The dilemma is, when I walk away, she follows. So what do you do when you have parents that won't let things go? You find out how to let them let it go. So usually with my mom, I'll just literally physically walk away to the point where she cannot catch me. And then she'll usually go to church and meditate. So remember, if you claim to be the person who knows better, if you claim to be the woke person, if you claim to be this gay person who's enlightened and your conservative family isn't, then you have to be the person to be the bigger person. And I hate to say it, but sometimes children parent their parents. Now, my parents are very parents. They're parent parents. You know, they're adult adults. So when I interact with them, I still feel like a child. I always feel like I'm 15 when I'm home. And at the same time, I see them with such great respect and adoration and love that I can have the humility in order to be the bigger person when needed. I think that's sort of key for me. Oh, wait, so the next question is, can you talk more specifically about how you did deal with the differences with your family on a day-to-day basis? I'm working to strengthen the bond with my mom, but many times I do not know what to do with the things in which she does not understand my point of view. I'm not trying to change hers, only to build from our differences. I would love to hear your experience in that regard. So first and foremost, I moved out. So that's kind of key for me, is I moved out at 21 and I only ever came back if I was really in a bad place and I needed to stay there temporarily to go somewhere new. Or on occasion, we'd reattempt for me to live there again. It just never worked. So I don't live with my parents. I live outside the home. I make sure never to go back home. I make sure to make it clear I'm going to buy a house and live on my own and not ever go back to my parents' house because I can't maintain harmony. I literally am a anti-liar, so I do not lie to the best of my ability. I have a very strong value system around lying. I think it's better just to say, no, I will not answer that question, or I'm going to answer that question to the best of my ability in a way that will not upset you intentionally, but might upset you unintentionally. So for me, unless my life is being threatened, I do not lie. I think it's weird. And I'm not going to participate in that, which means when I'm around my parents and they ask a question, they're going to get the truth from me, or at least my version of the truth. And so that can be very triggering for them. So if you're living with your parents, I think the biggest part of it is to acknowledge that, in my opinion, out of respect to the fact that they brought you into this world and like haven't housed and clothed you, assuming you didn't come from an extremely abused background in which you do not want a relationship with these people, right? I'm assuming your parents are good enough to have a relationship with, then you need to pay them homage and allow them to be people. I think one of the things that I really want to push on this channel is that our parents are people like we are. You know how we're fucked up and we're a mess and we're on TikTok and we're making jokes? Yeah, so are our parents. Now, some of our parents, even when they're adult, like mine, they still have a lot of, you know, growing to do, and they recognize that. And I think all of us become children in certain aspects. Like, I saw when my grandfather died, my father really had a childlike energy to him during that time. And I could imagine that that's what I'll be like when I lose my parent, right? So we need to recognize our parents are people on a journey, and they're going to be suffering just like we are, but in different specific ways. And so in order to make peace and maintain that harmony, I think it's just important to know the rules of your family, understand their boundaries sometimes better than they can understand it, and just be aware of it. You know, I try really hard, like I said, to not trigger people in my inner circle. Of course, it could happen. Of course, we could have conversations that go bad. But since I know them, I try not to do it. And if it does happen, we apologize and we move on. And that is a different conversation than the community. I know a lot of people say, oh, Brittany, well, what if you trigger someone on your YouTube channel? I'm not going to hold that much responsibility for the world, but I will hold that responsibility for my inner circle. And I think that's very different. So you're really willing to make the movement, but remember not to have a goal in mind, i.e. when you're getting to know your mom and meet her in the middle, make sure you're meeting her where she really is instead of where you want her to go. And make sure you're not holding out for her to be a person she'll never be. Like, I don't know that my mom will ever accept homosexuality. I'm just working to attempt to get her prepared to have queer grandkids, but I can't guarantee it. She might die a staunch anti, like, gay person, which is, again, her prerogative. Like, her one life, she gets to live it the way she wants. But I also, that means I also have to stick clear to my boundaries and make it clear to her the consequence of being this person is that you don't get to babysit my kids solo because I will not send my queer kids to their grandparents' house if their grandparents are going to convince them that they're wrong. And that's not something I would have to worry about with my straight kids necessarily, because again, it's going to be very specific to how it's going to go. And again, my mom can change. She can say, okay, if your kids come over, I'm not going to mention gay stuff, period. And that I'll leave it to you. That'd be great. But I know my mom. My mom is like me, and we're very like aggressive. And so my mom will do the grandma thing and be like, hey kids, here's some church passage about this. Again, people might hear that and go, oh my God, that's so offensive. I can't believe she would do that. And again, I don't even know if she would, because we've never had a grandkid who was gay to see her do it. But I can allow myself an opportunity to assume, worst case scenario, that's what she does. Because that's as bad as it would get. As bad as it would get is my parents saying that stuff to their grandkids. It wouldn't be anything else. My parents are not going to hit my kids. My parents are not going to, you know, ooh, don't be gay. My parents are not going to talk crap on me. They would never. They would never bash their children to their grandkids. Never, 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 never. So you have to understand, there's a great amount of respect here, while understanding that my mom is Catholic and she's going to make sure mass is on when the kids are over. And at the same time, understand that, oh, she knows there's a line to cross. So again, my mom can make all the choices she wants when we come to that point. And that's kind of the reality of our life, is that, you know, they talked a big game before their kids came out. And when their kids came out, they never banned us from the house. They made it really uncomfortable, but they never did the things they said they threatened to do. So frankly, I think a lot of parents talk a really big game. A lot of kids internalize it, create a lot of trauma around it. And then when it actually happens and real life occurs, a lot of our parents pussy around their beliefs and still invite us over for Thanksgiving. And if your parents don't, I'm so sorry. Losing your family because you're LGBT is very difficult. There's just like no way around that, right? That's going to be some people's stories. So I consider myself very lucky to have had, at least have my parents. Like, I could call my mom right now and be like, yo, what up? And we could talk. Even though we had an argument a couple weekends ago, it doesn't matter. So who what? Who cares? We get over it. We move on. We go on with our life. Because we have already come so close to losing each other so many times that I think we've all recognized it is better to all be together, regardless of how much we disagree, than to, God forbid, ever lose each other preemptively, because we've already gotten so close already. So I think that's the thing. My family's gone through so many hurdles, so many close calls of suicide that we're like, okay, guys, everybody stop trying to kill themselves. Let's get along. We'll move on. So there was one last comment that I had gotten, but I screenshotted it. I swear I had it, and now I can't find it. So if I recall correctly, it wasn't so much about being LGBT, but I thought it was appropriate for this podcast. It was just about growing up in a specific religion and then converting out of it or marrying out of it. And basically, what it's like having parents who have strong belief systems. And what do you do when you become the thing that they weren't expecting you to become? When they say snide comments like, oh, I'm okay with this ethnicity or this group, but I don't want you to necessarily marry them. Well, religion is very specific. It causes a belief to become the prominent foundation for that thinker. And then in contrast, their children will often hold a different belief, and therefore they are at an odds with what reality is. So as an example, my mom is Catholic and she grew up with a lot of Muslims in Iraq, obviously has no problem with the concept of a Muslim. But if you ask her religiously what her thoughts are, very negative thinking, obviously. Same with Mormons, same with Jehovah's Witness. Obviously, as a Catholic, she has strong feelings about religious communities that are not hers. Now, most Christian denominations she still raises an eyebrow at, but ultimately she would rather I marry a Christian than a Muslim or a Mormon background, because that's so far removed from how we view what Christianity is, even though Mormonism, you could argue, is an overlap because Jesus Christ, but same, but not. Catholics and Mormons are not the same, right? So again, how we're having these conversations matter. What's your goal? What's your intent? Ultimately, we're all adults. We have one single life in existence. We can equally love our parents and love our families while saying, I need to keep a distance. It is not wrong to say, I love you, but I have boundaries. I do not need to go over if every time I come over, I run the risk of getting triggered. And if you're like me and many people in my audience, if you grew up with a minority parent in a strong religion who has a strong cultural bound or bond and values that is predicated around that culture and background, then they're going to panic for the soul that is, you know, that is our souls. They're going to panic for our souls and they're going to bring that anxiety into our conversations. And so you have to always be the one sort of comforting and reminding and creating distance. So again, my mom is really respectful. My parents are super respectful of my space. They'll give it to me, but I can feel the worry and that makes me worry. I lose sleep over my parents worrying about me. And I'm like, wow, how do we fix this? Well, a big part of fixing it is radically accepting our parents for who they are and saying, okay, we do not have the same upbringing. We have had different instances of interactions with these set groups of people. We have fallen in love outside the bounds of your expectation, and we need to just find ourselves within that path. You, as adults in your one limited life, get to follow the path you want to follow, and still there's a consequence, and that could be losing relationships with your parents. And in the same turn, your parents could be losing their relationship with you because of their limitations. So we are all limited, putting judgments and limitations on each other. And I'm sorry, but to maintain healthy relationships, I think it's necessary. I think people who have this idea that, oh, a healthy relationship is someone who accepts every part of you at all times, is living in an illusion of, like, I don't know, Candyland. Like, where do you live? Like, what reality are you living in which the people you have in your life are only ever good people? Because I'm going to be honest, I have people who are struggling. I am a struggling person. A lot of us are struggling. You know, I'm struggling with my weird philosophies and my job and my lifestyle, balancing my family's feelings with my feelings. You know, we're all struggling in different ways. But I don't know who and in what reality you all have parents that just let you, you know, I don't know if you all are just disrespecting your parents, but sometimes I see these online posts of different kinds of kids interacting with their folks. And I'm like, y'all do not respect your folks. Like, it's just disrespectful acting like, I don't know, like not paying attention to your parents' feelings, I think is disrespectful. Even when your parents are wrong, denying them their feelings, I think is still wrong. Okay, I don't know what kind of house you guys are being raised in, but like I come from a culture where like you respect your parents, you respect their limitations, and then in turn, they teach you to respect your own. So yes, I respect my parents. I would never disrespect them in their own home, right? Unless you count arguing with them disrespect, but my parents don't. My parents encourage conversation. So we'll have our conversations, we'll say our piece, we'll walk away, right? Well, I've seen other people interact with their parents where they're like, my parents are awful. They better accept me. I can't believe my parents are crazy Trumpers. They're crazy this, they're crazy that. And I'm just sitting here like, the way you talk about your family. And like, don't get me wrong. I can talk smack. I can be like, my mom's crazy. My mom, I can say that for me. But if somebody else came at my mama, I expect you to freaking AK-47 protect her. And the thing I'm seeing is like that line isn't quite understood. We're not talking again about toxic, abusive parents that you don't want in your life. We're talking about parents who have a little bit of a disagreement with you about, yes, your technical existence, but you're going to make it through because you love your family and you know and understand where they're coming from. So again, we're going to put limitations on ourselves and grow and become adults and say, hey, if you act this way, here's the consequence. You don't get to hang out with me. And they, as adults, will do the same. And that's what being an adult is. Knowing your boundaries, putting your feet down and saying, this is how I maintain my happiness with you in my life or with you outside of my life. So again, I have an inner circle. I love my inner circle. My inner circle has boundaries still. Even my own sister, I get very exhausting for her, will tell me, Brittany, I love you. We spent too much time today together. I need my time. And I'm like, got it. I don't take it personal. I get it. I do. My sister needs space for me sometimes, so I give her that space. I need space sometimes. I need to go in my room and just watch anime and talk to nobody. I get it. I totally do. If we just saw this as us making a decision rooted in consent to maintain happiness, even if that means space, I think we'd be able to process these things better. But because we grew up in a society, maybe you didn't, but I most certainly did, that kind of told me that if I didn't have a relationship with my parents, I was broken. And in some ways, that's objectively true. And in other ways, if you come from enough of a toxic background, you could argue that that's the most healthy and good thing to do. So again, you have to know what situation you're in and know how to assess it. I love my parents. I will take a bullet for my parents. I will fight everybody on this planet for my parents. And at the same time, I have to make it clear to my parents, I do not believe in their God. I do not live their life. I do not hold the same values or morals. And when I come home to my space, this is a queer, LGBT-friendly household that is pro-drugs, pro-porn, pro-life, pro-choice, pro-everything. We We chillin' in this house. And as long as everyone's respecting each other and remaining calm and enjoying the atmosphere, you know, it's about maintaining space in the world, in our homes, and in our communities. Don't panic. If you have a family who says they won't love you if you do the X, Y, and Z. Sometimes actions speak louder than words. My parents say the most outrageous things. And ultimately, I pay attention to their actions. Because when you love your child the way I know my parents love me, sometimes that child, even when they are the black sheep, they feel the love, the desire my parents have to always be in our lives. My dad just bought me an electric guitar. That is love, my friends. Because my dad knows I'm learning guitar. He loves guitar. He wants me to do this to bond with him. He loves me. My mom invites me over, sends me recipes, calls me on the phone, answers all my phone calls, never leaves me on read. This is love. Love. So start recognizing when people actually love you in your life and when people don't. Because let me tell you, girl, one little Middle Eastern goodbye here. I'm about to wrap up, but one last thought. How many of us came from these kinds of homes? Maybe have borderline, dated really shitty people because they played such a beautiful game of poetry, said all the words we needed to say because we never heard them growing up, and then we ended up in relationships that were toxic and awful and cheating and bullshit because their actions didn't follow. I'd rather have parents that talk shit every fucking day to me, but still never fucking betray me, never cheat on me, never ever do anything to fuck with my life or my job. The people who ride and die for me, those are the people that I love. You get what I'm saying? Don't be deceived by words. Be aware of actions. All right. Thanks for watching. Have a great day. I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, da, 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 da.